Morning, everybody. Hope you're well. It's an absolutely beautiful day down on the coast this morning. It's a bit later today. It's about 10 to 9. I went on a run, which was brutal, just terrible. Bad running, no energy. I don't know why. Had a nice early night. But anyway, black coffee, second mug. We're going in. The window repairman, who's doing upstairs flats windows, is already in. So if you hear some bizarre sort of polyrhythmic avant-garde rhythm going on, it's not me bongoing or somebody just out of shot laying down some beats. It's Mr. Someone or Other upstairs with a mallet just banging at a window frame. What happened at the weekend? We did a morning coffee on Saturday morning. That was really fun. We played Rundown for Dave for his birthday. We played Graveyard for Henry's birthday. And Henry's 11, one of my pupils. And then we played Lucky Man by The Verve, which was really fun. With Sarah on cello, which was great. And a bit of Sunny Afternoon by The Kinks. It was nice. And I think the last time I saw you guys was Friday. I did get high, and lots of nice comments. I asked, in the video, I asked what you guys thought about maybe just doing the lives and not doing these videos, and what most of you said was that you like them both for different reasons and that I must just do whatever I can fit in. I teach at four different schools, and one of them is a state school and the other three are private secondary schools. And the private schools break up in 2 weeks. So I might go a bit quiet on the pre-recorded videos, on these videos, and maybe just stick to the lives for the next couple of weeks, just because of time. And I'm also finding that I'm not really writing very much, which is definitely not the point, or something that these videos should be doing. So I'll just see how it goes. But you know, if I have a song that springs to mind to do, then I'll do it. And I think what most of you have just said is just chill out and stop worrying about it and just do whatever you want. So I want to do that. Danielle says, I enjoy both of your sets of waffling. The live ones do have the edge a bit more, but I like to catch up on your normal daily ones at the end of the day when I get a break from the kids. It helps me to reset and wind down a bit. Of course, you need to do whatever is good for you and the rest of the waffle gang. Who are the waffle gang? Sarah? Or like the listeners? I think Sarah and I are in the waffle gang. Robert says, does this mean you bagged a slot on the next Travis tour? Oh, that's in relation to Fran Healy saying that he liked my cover. I don't think so, unfortunately. I can't even see there being any kind of tours for the next couple of years, but let's see what happens. Maria O'Hara Harris says, I love this one, Tom. Colin says, probably not worth trying the Meatloaf song. Your tone when you mentioned his name was enough. sorry, Colin. I've never really listened to Meatloaf. As a Springsteen fan, for me, it's like listening to... I don't know. I can't think of a band that I want to slag off. But do you know what I mean? It's like a pastiche version of it. But actually, somebody else says, Jules says, it is actually a good song. You should give it one listen at least. David says, the live stuff is really entertaining, but the weekday morning coffee wittertainment is entertaining and informative. They are different, but both great and something to look forward to in these depressing times. It's a wonderful thing that you do. As someone who only has your CDs and have never seen you live, I feel like the lockdown has given me the opportunity to get to know you and better understand the music. Obviously, it's a tough task for you to keep going, but when it is time, don't give us cold turkey. Wean us off slowly. Thanks, David. David was also showing me pictures of his beautiful 70s Telecaster the other day, which I really enjoyed. We've both got a 1973 telly, although slightly different. But if anyone else has any old guitars they want to send me pictures of, I'm always up for that. Jules says, love that my post amused you. Jules said, this is in relation to Jules saying that she'd unsuccessfully tried to... lose her virginity to the river and so could never listen to it in the same way. Jules says, I'm love that my post amused you. If anyone has successfully lost their virginity to the river, do let me know. No one has commented. It's quite a serious, sad song, isn't it? Julie says, lovely to hear Get High explanation. I do like that song. Thanks for doing the morning coffees. I enjoy them, but don't want you to feel that you have to keep doing them at the expense of your sanity. Love the lives too. It's great to hear and see you and Sarah singing and playing together. Was that Coco you played on today? Such a pretty guitar. See you Saturday. Julie, yes, I'm not going mad. I'm fine. I like doing the videos. It's just about time. But I'm going to keep going as much as long as I can. If these pre-recorded ones become less regular, it's just because I'm working and or writing songs. But the lives, I think we should keep going because Sarah and I both love doing them. Julie says, it was a great version of the Travis song and I re-listened to the album this week, still remembered the words. Ian says, hi Tom, love these deep dives into songs and lyrics. Huge fan of Rick Beato's videos and these are like the lyrical version of them. I think, does Rick Beato do sort of, he does recording, going into on recordings, does he? Because he's something to do, he's a recording engineer. I think I've seen the odd video come up on YouTube. Very timely video for me as I was learning this song just last night, Get High. Spent ages trying to work out if you use the fourth finger in the shape for the third chord. Trying to think. I don't know. You could probably tell from that video, Ian. Well, hang on, I'll tell you now. I think what I was doing is second, third, and fourth finger for that funny C shape. So 3-3-2. Trustworthy man. And then up to 5-5-4. And then I'm using my second and third fingers for that A7 shape. 5-4. I think that's what I'm doing. But who knows, Ian? Who knows the mysteries of Get High? Super complex. Question. No. What does it feel like to have people cover your songs? Is it a bit weird hearing other people sing the words and play the chords that came out of your head, or is it nice to see a different take on them? It's weird, Ian, but I also enjoy it. It's also especially funny if I hear people sort of doing a slight impression of me, because then I realise it's a head spinner to hear what people think you sound like. Well, they're right, really, aren't they? What I think I sound like is neither here nor there. Doesn't matter. I've said... Oh yeah, and then we were just talking about writing with other people. Some nice comments on Twitter. Chris says, Get High is a great track, brilliant video too. Loving the daily positive waffle, finding it more difficult to catch up daily now and back at work. Much easier during my 2 months of furlough. However, I would also be happy with lives only, especially if you need a break. Steve says, great track, clever video. Yeah, if you haven't seen the Get High video, it's great. Ben Phillips designed it all and made all the balloon band, and it was filmed by the guys at Brother, who also did the It's Dark Now video. Joe says, enjoyed the chat this morning. I've always loved Get High, but I'm ashamed to say I've never really listened closely to the lyrics. Some great lines. A man's first defeat. Brilliant. These positive waffles are a highlight of the day for me, but don't let them become a burden. Take care. And then Joe commented, tweeted sort of minutes later, I've just watched the Get High video. Brilliant. and then Instagram. Neil says, this is such a banger. What a great song. Total favourite. The recorded morning coffees are great. Never stop, ever. Have a great weekend. Okay, thanks, Neil. Leah says, unfortunately, I haven't been watching as many morning coffees as usual lately as I lost my job a while back and don't have the schedule that I used to. I loved watching while I was eating breakfast. Please don't stop making these unless you don't want to. I went from being a casual fan to a massive fan through this lockdown. I really enjoy your acoustic sets and more so your chatter and the musicians you love and the stories and inspirations behind your music. You have a real gift for writing lyrics. I'm not really one for quote-unquote stuff, and tend to lean towards digital downloads versus physical CDs or vinyl. But as soon as I can afford it, I'd love to buy your discography, if only to read the lyrics whilst enjoying your music through my beloved headphones. Keep on doing what you're doing. I have nothing but love and utter respect for you and all you do for us fans. Leah, very sweet. What a lovely message, thank you. Rose says, never any pressure intended on you, Tom, but I'm definitely still loving these videos. Really been enjoying any slash all of the discussions of the songs, whether the covers or your brilliant originals. June has been a mad month over here, personally, and obviously in the general world, but I think I'm just about caught up with morning coffee slash Wednesday whiskey, and have very much appreciated having the music as a needed break from everything else going on. Thanks again to you and Sarah both. Hope you have a great weekend. Thanks, Rose. God, you guys are nice, aren't you? Loads of other comments here. I better quickly get to the song. Nick says, I don't do Facebook, so I don't see the live programs as live anyway. I catch up on YouTube as and when I can. I kind of prefer these non-live ones, but only because they're the right way round. Oh yes, it flips the camera. If you're happy to post stuff, I'll be happy to carry on watching. This is an interesting question from Paul Cronell. Paul, I hope I've said your name right. These videos exist in so many different places, I'm never sure where best to leave a comment. I know these videos are not invitations to be interviewed, but I have a question. I'm not a musician, I'm a writer, but I'm interested in how all creative people work, and it's fascinating to hear you talk through a song you've written. Clearly the foundation slash raw materials, etc. of the song are deeply meaningful during its creation, but when you sing them live, months and years later, apologies, this is a very long waffle of a question, how do you personally relive the birth slash emotions of the song? And how much is it an exercise in making sure your listeners get a technically perfect rendition? Good question, badly constructed, exclamation mark. I've written, hi Paul, I think often people presume that you revisit the exact emotions you had when you write a song, when you wrote a song every time you sing it. But there's also a process of actively trying to remember the emotions you had when you wrote it, especially if the lyrics are a bit more abstract. Yeah, I'm sort of agreeing with myself here, but often you just can't remember how you felt. You feel like it's for like reading the words of a completely different person. I mean, often there are songs where you can relate more, you know, immediately to it, but there are some songs where it feels like from a different lifetime ago. And then I've written, I also think that sometimes in an effort to imbue the song with real emotion, sort of like a present emotion, what I'm trying to say is sometimes rather than trying to remember an emotion, you can bring a new emotional vitality to a performance by changing a melody and rhythm slightly because it feels like you're breathing new life into it. This is definitely how I see what Dylan does on stage, often changing a song's shape completely to animate it anew with a whole new life force. Not sure if that answers the question. Does it answer the question? Deeply, the foundation's raw material is deeply meaningful during its creation, but when you sing them live months and years later, how much do you personally relive the birth emotions of the song? I think a problem with songwriting is also you're often in a sort of a semi-conscious state when you're writing it, so you can't necessarily, there's also always a slight awe at what you've created at the end of it, and you have that sort of surprised, or at it, at every stage of its creation. You love it when you first write it, you love listening to the first demo of it, then you love playing it for the first time with the band, then you love rehearsing it, then you love recording it, then you love playing it live, and the song changes all the time. And it also keeps stacking up the memories of it as well. So it's very difficult to necessarily remember how you felt when you were sort of sitting on the edge of your bed writing it. But I'm definitely a very visual person, and I do often remember when and where I wrote things, the rooms, the time of the day, the weather. So I've got that for a lot of things. But then for other songs, I've got memories of playing it live, or memories of rehearsing it with the band, or memories of recording it. So it's tricky. Gary says, as a non-songwriter but solely a listener, I still concur with Callum. I am fully prepared to join in the peer pressure on you to keep doing these. Just make sure you do them at a frequency that is good for you. Callum says, I love these videos. I love the live videos. If you're happy to keep them going, then I'm sure I can speak for everyone that would love to see you talk through more songs. As a songwriter myself, it's an interesting perspective to hear you take on the songs, and I can appreciate them more. Lovely comments. Thank you all so much. Let me quickly play a song for you. This is a song by one of my favourite songwriters and performers, and she's called Gillian Welch, and this is a song off the first album that I heard of hers called Time the Revelator. For me, it's very like Bringing It All Back Home in a way by Dylan, in that you've got these enormous songs, sort of very, very long songs that lyrically seem to be about everything, and they seem to have the whole universe in their words. But then there are also sort of lighter songs and little sort of skiffly, bluesy, bluegrassy songs as well. This is weirdly a song that has definitely become one of the most covered songs of her career. Lots of people have covered it, and they've covered it. This song was released in 2001, so I guess at that point, we're talking about Napster, we're talking about LimeWire, and all the different technologies that were changing the way that people consume music, but also massively affecting the bottom lines for a lot of record companies and a lot of artists. So, this is not the most pertinent subject to be talking about at the moment, but it's a beautiful song. I'll play it and then see what happens, chatting wise. Right. Should maybe tune this before we started, but you know. Everything is free now, that's what they say. Everything I've ever done, gonna give it away. Someone hit the big score, they figured it out. They were gonna do it anyway, even if it doesn't pay. I can get a tip jar, gas up the car, try to make a little change down at the bar. Or I can get a straight job, I've done it before. Never mind it working hard, it's who I'm working for. 'Cause everything is free now, that's what they say. Everything I ever done, gonna give it away. Someone hit the big score, they figured it out. They were gonna do it anyway, even if it doesn't pay. This is my favorite verse, this one. Every day I wake up humming a song, but I don't need to run around, I just stay at home, sing a little love song, my love and myself. If there's something that you wanna hear, you can sing it yourself. 'Cause everything is free now, that's what I say. No one's gotta listen to the words in my head. And someone hit the big score, I figured it out. That I'm gonna do it anyway, even if it doesn't pay. video just cut out my phone because I've run out of storage. This waffle is going on far too long anyway, but it's a lovely, lovely song. The album is called Time the Revelator by Gillian Welch. Her and her husband, Dave Rawlings, have this sort of amazing creative partnership where they co-write all their songs together, whether it's for her album or his album, and they always tour as a duo. And they sing and play on each other's stuff. And, you know, for me, Gillian is like, as a performer, as a writer, as a singer, she's definitely, you know, top five of artists in my lifetime. You know, her songs really have a depth, a spiritual depth and a wisdom to them. That is just, you know, it puts us sort of in a class of one for me. And this song is great. And obviously, you know, there's been a lot of talk in this lockdown as the entertainment industry has collapsed about how to support artists. And it's a nice reminder, and you guys all do it already, but, you know, the concept of like direct-to-fan communication was almost non-existent at that point. In 2001, and it's so interesting how we all communicate now, and you know that I can put up a recording I've made on my phone, and you can get it on Bandcamp, and you can buy a t-shirt and a mug directly from me, and you can, you know, you can buy records and stuff from my online store, and you know, we can chat to each other and have a conversation and actually make a real connection rather than sort of being behind some funny sort of 3-foot barrier at the front of the stage. So it's a reminder in a way of how much the world has changed and how quickly the world can change, but also how precious these things are, and how they're worth protecting, and how the creative arts are worth protecting and nurturing, whether it's small venues, whether it's artists, whether it's creative spaces, theatre companies, dance groups, all that kind of thing. It's so good for our mental health, our well-being, our physical well-being, our spiritual well-being. Yeah. There's just so many great lines in this. I've never minded working hard, it's who I'm working for. Yeah, it's just great. This whole song is fantastic. But I better go because this video is going to get too long. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you so much for all your lovely comments. I might be back tomorrow, but if I'm not, I will be definitely back on Wednesday evening, 9 p.m. for a live Wednesday Whiskey on Facebook. Have a lovely week. And if you haven't already, listen to Time the Revelator, which is the album by Gillian Welch. It's just a masterpiece, I think. But we'll see you guys soon. Bye-bye.